share your knowledge. It's a way to immortality. Dalai Lama says so. Delegates, students, teachers, researchers, scholars, a warm welcome, a warm greeting in the morning for all of you. Second day of our virtual national conference of IOTA is undergoing, starting with this session. I'm extremely honored to welcome our chairpersons, Dr. Sashi Oberoi, ma'am, and Dr. Karuna Nadkarni. The scientific session's theme is Occupational Therapy, Aiding Health, Function, Participation, and Quality of Life. I take immense pleasure in introducing the first chairperson, Dr. Sashi Oberoi. She's a former professor and dean of D.Y. Patil College of Occupational Therapy, D.Y. Patil University, Navi Mumbai. Presently working in the capacity of ex officio member of AIOTA. Earlier worked as the vice president of IOTA from 2016 to 2020 and has the honorary treasurer for two consecutive terms. She's awarded aptly with the Fellow of Academic Council of Occupational Therapy Award during OTCON 2020 at Mumbai. And she's felicitated with prestigious President Crown of Occupational Therapy Award during OTCON 2018 at Nagpur. She's been awarded with Professional Excellence Award by IOTA and ACOT for outstanding work in the profession. She was also the member, development group member in planning strategies for rehabilitation interventions in ischemic heart disease by WHO project, Health for All 2030. She has also completed the certificate course in vestibular rehabilitation by otcourses.com. Welcome, ma'am. I again have pleasure in welcoming Karuna Nadkarni, ma'am. She's the Associate Professor, Occupational Therapy, and in charge in Occupational Therapy Training School and Center, SGS Medical College and KM Hospital, Mumbai. She's a PhD scholar, UG and PG recognized teacher by the Maharashtra University of Health Sciences. She has been selected as the foundation member of steering committee of GSMC MUH's UNESCO Bioethics Unit since November 2015. She has served Bioethics Unit in the capacity of treasurer and co-editor of Bioethics Bulletin INARC. She has also worked in Wadia Children's Hospital, All India Institute of Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation, and as in the capacity of principal at SRM College of Occupational Therapy, Chennai. Welcome, ma'am. I welcome Sashi Oberoi, ma'am, to introduce the guest talk.
Thank you, Dr. Murli, for those kind words of appreciation. A very good morning to one and all present virtually. And thank you for joining us at OTCON 2021 for Scientific Session 3, Occupational Therapy, Aiding Health, Function, Participation, and Quality of Life. This holds very true for the elderly population. So we begin our session with a guest talk by Professor Dr. Nathan Vaithalingam. Dr. Nathan will talk on agelessness, the direction towards healthy aging. Introducing Dr. Nathan, a consultant occupational therapist practicing for the last 44 years. He has worked in London, Singapore, Australia, Malaysia, in areas of rehabilitation, specializing in physical medicine and rehabilitation, and has received Merit Award from the World Federation of Occupational Therapy for promoting his work on rehabilitation regionally and internationally in special interest on the aging population. Dr. Nathan is a past vice president of WFOT from 1994 to 1998, and in 2016, awarded with honorary fellow by WFOT. Dr. Nathan, Dean, Purdue University School of Occupational Therapy, elected in 2012, President of Asia Pacific Occupational Therapy, and advisor, Global Coalition on Aging. And in 2019, he has been elected President, Malaysian Occupational Therapists Association. So we are privileged to have such a learned and experienced occupational therapist and administrator to guide us on healthy aging. Thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation Over to you, Dr. Nathan.
Thanks very much, Dr. Shashi, and good morning to all of you all, to Murali and Shuri and etc., to the members of IOTA ICON, because I presume it's morning there and it's afternoon here already. It's it's actually 1:30 in the afternoon. And I really thank you all very much for having invited me to give this, deliver this 20 minutes lecture, and I hope I do justice to it. No one is an expert in everything, but obviously my interest in aging has grown because partly I'm aging itself. So I've moved on very much into that area. So good morning to all of you. I'm going to give you all an overview of agelessness, an area that is fast growing. And there's a lot of interest in this field, not only by healthcare professionals, but even the various institutions and governments as well. Because the governments realize the financial implications of people getting old, and that becomes a big issue and challenge itself. As Dr. Shashi has mentioned, it's about 44, actually it's more than 44 years. It's 48 years actually, that's of my years of experience. So I've got another 2 more years to hit 50. Hopefully, by God's grace, I'm there still, you know. I am very much into the area of aging itself. Now, I know that all of us know the statistics of aging, and that's one of the biggest challenges that everybody feels. Dr. John Beard, the former director of World WHO and the Division of Aging, he says, every country looks at statistics, but what we do with the statistics is the most important thing, you know. So you collect statistics and we always wonder what's next coming on into it. Now, if you look at it, obviously, you know, if you look at Africa is fast growing. And if you look at Asia, it is actually moving extremely fast. Many people don't realize the fastest growing is actually Asia in relation to aging point of view. And the fastest growing actually is not the developed countries in Asia, but the developing countries. So if you look at it, it's always Sri Lanka. You're looking at, you know, obviously Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos, Myanmar. Those sort of countries are very fast going in terms. One of the reasons why Sri Lanka, I quoted to you all, is because obviously the older generation are left behind and the younger generation have left the country because of the civil unrest. So that's one of the reasons why you find more in terms of the. So if you look at these figures, obviously the 1 in 8 people worldwide were age over 60 in 2017, but in 2050, you're going to get a bigger population of 1 in 5 people globally are going to be. So when you have this sort of statistics, it frightens you and you realize the need for more occupational therapies in the area of elderly care. And, you know, somehow, therapists have never moved very much into this area because many people don't like working with old people. Simple, full stop. They prefer to work with peds, children, you know, stroke patients because they feel the challenge there. But they don't realize the volume of challenge when you work with the older generation itself. So in Asia and that sort of thing, you can look at the statistics, you know, and obviously India is there and Malaysia. But if you look at it, Japan, China, these are the countries that, and South Korea, these are the countries that is developed to me. They do not have the problem as some of us have. And again, when you talk about aging and agelessness, obviously the cultural sensitivity of the people need to be taken into account. And one of the main challenges that you find is in our textbooks, they don't teach us about these sort of things because we are so dominated by the guidelines of in terms of aging, looking at the issues and challenges faced by Western countries, because they were the earlier pioneers in this area. But it's timely for us to look at this in a much broader spectrum itself. So if you look at the fast growing, I mean, obviously Singapore is one, and they will reach by 2035, about 26% of their population, and Thailand. Thailand is very fast growing in this part of the world. And as I mentioned earlier, Vietnam as well. So And these are some of the issues, the challenges that we face. Now, what is healthy aging and what are the keys to healthy aging? There's a lot of debate on the definitions of it. I will not go into detail of it. Obviously, the best definition to me is looking at lifespan right from birth to tomb. That is where you look at healthy aging, and that's how WHO defines it. But when you talk to most of the healthcare professionals, when you use the word healthy aging, they said, oh, yeah, got to do with old people. And that's how it thing. And there's just, you know, to me, there's no such thing as old people. They're people who are aging gracefully. And that's how we should not be negative in terms of those sort of things. So what is meant is obviously that the processes that we look at, you look at the functional capacity and abilities of the person. And obviously you need to look at building up people in this sort of areas, you know, and that's an important component itself that you will want to look at aging itself. So there are basically 10 keys to healthy aging. If you really look at it, there are basically 10. And if we can actually guide our clinicians, we guide our students to realize, and they are the best people to educate the public in relation to that. I mean, the first one is obviously to lower your systolic blood pressure, you know, and you know that that's the highest risk. And we know that stroke, cognitive heart failure, heart attack, you to look at kidney disease failures, all got to do with the blood pressure of oneself. And this is something very simple, easy to assist people. And one of the things I advocate is actually not to go to a gym or anything and try to do the regular walks that we do. And that's the most important thing. And so if we can educate our patients in relation to that, that becomes very useful. And you know, the high risk group is always a 55 to 65 age group. And that's one of the groups that you need to really look at. And obviously the cardiovascular morbidity is very high in this age group, and obviously once cognitive decline takes place, the ability to understand these things. So educating the younger generation, the importance and the impact of this is the most important thing. We are very good at telling everybody to stop smoking, but we don't tell them how to stop smoking. That's the biggest challenge. You always advise your clients, your patients, stop smoking, and that's important, but we do not tell them how to stop. And you can see by the studies itself that after just 20 minutes of heart rate drops to a healthier level as soon as you quit smoking. And that is so very, very important and useful. I'm giving you these because when we see clients, to me, it's important to educate them. But I always find that many of the biggest mistakes that we do is we tell somebody, hey, you should stop smoking, but you don't tell them the benefits, how, why, when. And that's important. So this clearly tells you after 20 minutes what happens. Your carbon monoxide level drops. And after 2 weeks or 3 months, the risk of MI also drops. The benefits are there. After 5 years, you can see that your SOP level decreases and your coughing decreases. And obviously, in terms of after X number of 10 years, what happens to you in terms of your lung, CA death rate is also reduced. Okay. So to participate in cancer screening is one of the important challenges that we face. And that is, nobody wants to go and screen themselves. And actually, you'll be very surprised, it's a very cultural thing. If you look at, because Malaysia is so, it's a multiracial country, and you find that the Chinese have got a fear of going to do cancer screening sometimes because nobody wants to hear what is happening to me and what's moving on, you know? So that's important to realize. So the obviously, breast screening and prostate cancer screening are the two main important factors in our life, you know. And you know that by that, the folds of increases because between the younger generation, the older generation, so the risk of among the age of 65 and above, 65 is taken at the cutoff point in WHO for the aging point of view, you know. But interesting, in some countries, like in Malaysia, we take 60 as a cutoff point for aging. So it varies from person to person, okay? So it's important for the seniors to become aware and to be aware that these are the possibilities that are likely to happen to them as well. So you need to realize tobacco, healthy weight, you know, get moving, alcohol, all the contributing factors, which falls back to educating the public, you know, and that's something that we need to really work on. And I think the best people to advocate public education, I found this, is actually the therapist, immaterial, whether it's an occupational therapist, a physiotherapist, or because we're so involved with our patients day to day, and they sort of respect you for your advice and everything. And that's important, you know. So the earlier the cancer is found, the more likely it can be treated successfully. Immunization, everybody talks about immunization these days, but nobody ever looks at influenza and pneumococcal. And that's a bigger killer than actually COVID-19, you know. And you need to realize the importance of this. And it's a strong advocate going on now in Malaysia for influenza vaccines, you know, and to encourage. And I'm sure it's the same in India next. And there, you know, that there is a certain lobby group that is anti-vaccine going on all over the world, you know. And some of it, you'll be surprised, it is actually done by healthcare professionals itself. I don't ask me why, but they should be looking at it in a reverse point of view. So proper immunizations are essential to healthy aging itself. And I must give a lot of gratitude and praise to India for coming out with your vaccines. And you all have started off your vaccination for COVID-19 extremely well. We are just starting off here. We are looking at vaccination. We are just started off with the frontliners, and we're now moving on to the senior citizens. By next month, the senior citizens. So hopefully I would be vaccinated by then. I'm a senior citizen itself, you know. So I'm looking forward to it. The other important factor is obviously your blood glucose. Simple, right? To regulate our blood. It's so preventable, these sort of illnesses. But everybody takes it for granted. You know, your fasting level, and you're looking at your after meals level. So you know that the risk factors, we all know that the kidney, loss of vision, heart, stroke, you know, peripheral neuropathy, which is one of the biggest challenges that we face in rehabilitation. You know, patients always wonder why this is happening to us, you know, and these are important factors to look at. So your blood glucose level is one thing that you need to look at. So pre-diabetics, so preventable to move on to the next level. You know, people always get not realizing that what happens to them, and they think that taking medication is an answer. Obviously, we know the long-term effects of medication itself. So you need to look at it and change lifestyle. You know, the diet that we are on. And, you know, carbs are one of the biggest killers in many of us. It's carbohydrates. But you can't help it, because you know, if you look at it, most Asians are rice eaters, you know, and that's where. So you need to look at it also in terms of cultural point of view itself. Lowering your LDL cholesterol is an important factor, you know, and that's, you got to bring it down to make sure that, you know, what is it? So you want to ask yourself, again, there's so much of things about butter, margarine, and, you know, now, you know, the argument went on at ghee and everything. And now, you know, ghee has come back as benefits of ghee. So, yeah, and I mean, I just saw this documentary about 2 months ago in BBC, you know, but how it revolves and comes back, and all because we are so influenced by some of the studies done overseas that we get caught up with those sort of, not realizing, you know, should I take skim milk, or do I take full cream milk, you know, but the skim milk, does it have vitamin D? There's so many questions, you know, and I can't answer all of it, because you need to realize the more we look at it and they read, and again, to me, the diet in this part of the region is totally different from the Western diet. And people, we still tend to seem to be looking at some of the diets from overseas itself. So in order to lower your cholesterol naturally, you always have to look at some of the things that we eat, you know, and whether we need to, you know, deep fry, or whether we need to look at it of just grilling the food and etc. You know, it's a lot of taste becomes an acquired taste of most people. And so it's very important to realize on these sort of things itself. I don't need to go into depth of this, but we all know that the value of being physically active, you know, and you realize that physical activity includes leisure, time, transportation, you know, the whole things, and obviously Tai Chi, Qigong, yoga, all the benefits have been proven, you know, and everybody sort of now into the bandwagon of doing physical activity, which is good. You know, even the younger generation seem to be caught up of doing a lot of physical activities itself. And we know the benefits, as therapists, we know the whole benefits of this whole gimmick of being physically active. And the importance of, you know, maintaining healthy bones and joints, you know. So the elements of this are so important. And one of the biggest things I find is sarcopenia among the older generation is that because of older generation somehow low physical activity and their diet nutrition status is low and then their protein and etc. And so when Toby did the study, they were right, you know. Sarcopenia is very common in the Asian region, partly because we are to be blamed. We always tell our grandparents and everything, oh yeah, stay in the house, don't walk, you may fall. And you know, we instill fear in some of the older generation, but not realizing all these things doesn't help because they need to keep themselves physically active and physically mobile and moving itself. So inactive lifestyles is going to cause obesity, and sometimes sitting in the house, poor nutrition, alcohol, the whole thing. And obviously that creates muscle weakness and osteoporosis, and obviously that's enough to create problems for oneself. Social contact is so important. You know, mental health is one of the biggest areas of challenges these days. A lot of therapists do not like to work in the mental health area. I don't know about India, but here we find difficulty getting therapists working in mental health areas, but it's fast growing now, you know, and you know, in WHO considered that as one of the fastest growing challenges in terms of wellness of the older generation itself. So the risk of, you know, so worthwhile to maintain contacts, you know, and especially when people retire, they don't know what to do with themselves. And retirement is a bad word, you know, to me. There's no such thing as retirement. You know, you should actually carry on working till you drop dead. That's all, full stop. I mean, you must be physically active, mentally. I'm not saying that you should be doing OT work, but you can actually do a lot of community work, and then a lot of social activities. So the role of OT is to provide meaningful and health promotions of social activities. It's so very important. And we have famous to conclude that depression is not a normal part. It's not a normal part of aging. But many people think depression in the older generation is common. No, it is not. And you need to realize we need to combat depression and loneliness. Loneliness is a killer. And if we look around us, how many times we have ourselves been lonely, you know, not realizing that, you know, the death of a spouse, you know, creates an issue, loss of a job, especially now with the COVID-19 situation. So many people have lost their jobs, and we have already had a high number of suicidal issues taking place in this country. My psychiatrist colleagues tell me that their clinics are full, you know. So there is a way of, obviously, we need to assess them. And one of the good things is therapists have got very good accumulative knowledge of how to help people to overcome depression. But we do not use it enough to educate the older generation of it. And we tend to fall into this, the geriatric syndrome of saying, yeah, it's common to be depressed when you get old, which is not true. So the other aspects of healthy aging itself, nutrition and aging, spirituality, recreation, financial health, caring for the age, preparing for death, which is a taboo subject for many people, and holistic approach to healthy aging. So if you look at nutrition and aging, obviously the first thing is the calorie needs. That's important. Patients coming to you for therapy, but if they're malnourished or undernourished, you can forget about therapy because the calorie intake is so very important. This way, clinically, we should liaise very much with the dietitian, etc., when you find patients in this category itself. You know, so you need to look at that because you can't do resistance training and strengthening muscles and muscle mass when my calorie intake is low, you know. So you need to look there, look at the type of food they're taking and also the portion of food they're eating, you know. Protein, you know, it's so very important, you know, but high quality protein, again, the cost element for someone in the financially difficult people have obviously going to have difficulty getting protein, you know, but you can get protein from eggs, etc., you know, some form of meat. But again, you know, you don't also forget there are vegans around. There are a lot of people who are vegan these days, and they need proteins as well, you know. So obviously, you know, I think we are quite lucky in terms of Indians that, you know, we know how to manage our protein because we get a lot of it from dal and et cetera and those sort of things, you know. So you get food that it gives you. Total neglected area in terms of aging. So if you want an agelessness, dental health is so important because it actually gives you a link to some of the illness processes that are taking place itself, you know. So yearly, you know, we should encourage, and I think it's so important to make it a mandatory for older generations to go for the dental. You know, we always tell them to go and do a physical exam, but we forget to encourage them for dental exams itself. So that's important, and to encourage dental health. Taste is something that the older generation don't realize. The sense of taste, smell, and they actually openly tell you when it comes to to the rehab clinic itself or to the OT department that they've lost taste buds, you know. And obviously we know that the number of reasons why this can happen to them. So you need to stay hydrated. You'll be surprised the number of old people do not drink enough water, you know, and that is something. And there's such thing as you can use herbs, etc., to help you. Antioxidants, beneficial to one's health. You need to use antioxidants and take your supplements. You know, that's Lester Parker, the father of antioxidants, obviously tells you the importance. Antioxidants are not necessary. You have to go and buy supplements. Your food alone has got enough antioxidants if we all take the correct diet itself, you know. Calcium and vitamin D, obviously sunlight is a useful thing, but, you know, in this country, you find that in Malaysia, very often you find the Chinese keep away from sunlight, you know, because they were in terms of, but now they realize the importance and value of sunlight. Everybody goes for their walk. Culturally, you know, Indians do not have a problem of drinking milk, you know, but again, someone who's got intolerance to milk will have an issue. But again, now we have found a very high number of Malaysian Chinese drink milk because of they realize the calcium, and more high number of Chinese are osteoporotic. You'll be very surprised, you know. So again, this is something that we need to look at and educate them as well. And vitamin D, obviously, sunlight is the best form of thing. So your dietary supplements, the sources are so many, you know. You can get dietary supplements from any sort of food that you eat, but obviously try to avoid buying all the supplements in the market that is being sold. But the diet is one of the best things to look at. Water is often a forgotten nutrient. You know, we all now, I realize now that a lot of younger generation carry a lot of water bottles all over and drinking a lot of water, which is a good sign, you know, so that when they get old, they do not have to have the worry of this. And, you know, and very often you find the older generation do not drink enough, and they have need to drink a lot of water itself to assist them in terms of diuretic. And obviously that affects your kidney in terms of long term, they do not drink enough water itself. So as the father of medicine has said, let food be thy medicine and medicine be thy food. We cannot forget that, you know, but we do not seem to advocate it. And I think that's the best statement I've ever you hear to my talk today. This is the best light to me, you know, food be thy medicine. Spirituality is something that is fast growing all over the world in terms of for the older generation, and it's so important component in one's life, you know. So we need to look at spirituality It's a source of sense of connectedness. I'm sure this is not a big issue in India, you know, or in the Asian countries. But if you look at some cultural point of view, some people now only opening their eyes, realizing the importance of spirituality. You know, do we need to get it from Western sources? Sorry, I don't agree to it. It is actually from your birth land itself. But we have never highlighted the importance of spirituality in many ways in terms of therapy itself. And I think it's an important component. I actually encourage spirituality in the OT curriculum itself. I'm sure many of you do as well, you know, so that's important itself. And we know what's the benefits of it. You know, completely we are aware that the benefits of spirituality in terms of that. So spirituality practices, meditation, mind-body exercises, involvement of connecting with nature. Going for a walk in nature is such an important thing. Walking barefoot on the grass, to me, is so very important. We forget all the basics of life, you know, and that's so important in terms of you want to age well. People now have actually realized the value of walking barefoot for a few minutes on surface itself, you know. Aging and recreation is important. I won't go so much into this because you know that there's so any form of value of this itself that you important to promote it. So you know that socialization helps. We know that learning new skills, you know, using your talent, all these things are important, you know, for the older generation. So your interest, strength, abilities, environment, you need to enjoy looking at the positive side of it. And encourage the older generation, and some may not be aware of it, the aspects of recreation, you know. And we know as therapists that leisure and recreation is one important component in our area itself. Financial health and aging, there's a big issue that's taking place of poverty, lack of financial resources, all those things, because you're wondering, what has this got to do with agelessness? Obviously it does, because you don't, financially, you're not secure in old age, everything starts happening to you, you deteriorate, you know. So financial issues are important. And we know that now because of COVID-19, again, you know, this has again affect a lot of financial aspects of people itself, you know. I need to mention this, the abuse of older people in terms of financial health, you know. And there's a lot, it's fast growing. I'm sure in India it happens, it even happens here. The abuse of the younger generation towards the older generation, as not so much of physical and sexual abuse. No, it is basically financial abuse. And that is something that you need to, I can tell you that's a dangerous thing that's happening. So in terms of caring for the aged, things to consider is obviously holistic care, IADLs, you know, your finances, living arrangements, ADL, you know, to me, get educated and get help from support group for the older generation is so important. We do not use the word elderly anymore. We use the word older generation because it is becoming very negative, the term elderly, you know. It sounds very negative. So it's nicer to say I'm an older person rather than saying I'm an elderly. Preparing for death is an important thing to me, and I think generally, Asians prepare themselves in some ways for death. I find the Muslims are very good at preparing for death. You know, they accept that as a part and parcel of life. I'm not sure about India, but in this country, the Muslims handle death much better than some of the other races itself. So it's interesting to do a multicultural study on some of these issues itself. So why is it important? Death is part of our life. You can't run from that. You know, and you know that family and friends need to help to arrange things accordingly. Coincidentally, just about 2 days ago, I was talking to an older person about her husband being in the hospital and how she should be able to prepare herself and her family if things happen the other way around. So to conclude, a holistic approach to healthy aging is so important. There is no one thing that say, okay, I'm aging healthily. It's a holistic approach. And we need to realize that in ourselves. So the physical, emotional, mental, and spiritual well-being are important factors that need to be taken into account. So Ochi's contribution to active aging and healthy well-being in so many areas. We already do prevention of falls. We look at accessibility of homes, you know, and you look at mobility, you look at education. All these are being done by Ochi's. But I think we have to move to a different higher level, looking at aging in a different perspective itself, looking at aging in a better spectrum itself, and making them realize that we play a very good role in educating the public. So the primary goal is obviously looking at participation of our people in terms of modifying their environments and betterness. So with that, thank you very much. I believe in aging gracefully. Thank you very much for inviting me.
Thank you, Dr. Nathan. You have rightly said that aging is not it does not just happen. It is a process and it is an outcome. And you very rightly use the word not elderly, but aging. I think that is a better word to be used, as we do not, we only age, we do not get old, and we are not elderly.
And of course,
as you highlighted, occupational therapists have a major role for the aged, because we can help them with the modification, home environment changes, and healthy living. What tips you have given, all this is part of OT. We can definitely help them to reintegrate into community, and that is the best thing we can do for them. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for this enlightening talk.
Thanks.
Now I hand over to Dr. Karuna to call the speakers one by one. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Nathan, sir, for emphasizing quality of life in the older people. Now we begin with our scientific session. Yes, Murli, we should go ahead.
Yes, ma'am, please go ahead.
Okay, yes. So we begin with our scientific session, and the first paper is by Dr. Sanjeev Kumar. He is going to speak on effect of simulated functional tasks to improve executive functions, functional balance, and ADL in elderly people with MCI. Please, Sanjeev Kumar.
Thank you, ma'am. Good morning to all. My topic is effect of simulated functional tasks to improve executive function, functional balance, and activities of daily living in elderly people with a mild cognitive impairment. Introduction. Executive function is a consist of complex attention and working memory and verbal and visual organization and planning and judgment and reasoning. Elderly people with mild cognitive impairment may represent the group with whom executive defect and gait abnormalities. Executive skills are required to perform ADL and IADL. Even mild executive dysfunction could have impact on functional ability. The risk of ADL dependence among older adults with MCI. Simulated functional task, FCT SIM program, is specifically facilitate the cognitive function of working memory and executive function with the purpose of enhancing the daily functional status of older person with mild cognitive impairment. The therapeutic use of everyday life activities means occupation with the individual or group for the purpose of enhancing or enabling the participation in roles and habits and routines. Here the occupation-based intervention plans that changes the growth in the client factors and skills. The need of the study, individual with mild cognitive impairment may represent the problem in executive function and gait and are the more susceptible to fall. FCT SIM said to improvement in executive function, functional balance, but there is no research evidence on implementation of simulated functional tasks on activities of daily living. Hence, this study will be focusing on implementation of simulated functional tasks on activities of daily living to improve executive function, functional balance, and the aims to find the effectiveness of simulated functional tasks to improve executive function, functional balance, and activities of daily living in elderly people with mild cognitive impairment. Here, two hypotheses are formulated. Alternate hypothesis, simulated functional task is effective in improving executive function, functional balance, and ADL. Null hypothesis, simulated functional task is not effective in improving executive function, functional balance, and ADL. Here the methodology, quasi-experimental pre- and post-test single group design, and it's a quantitative study. Here we use convenient sampling technique We include 15 participants who are selected from old age home and elderly care center in and around Coimbatore. The variables, dependent variables, are executive function, functional balance, and ADL. FCTSIM or independent variable. The selection criteria, we included age of 60 to 85 year old people and gender both male and female. Individual with mild cognitive impairment, we used to screen MMSE score between 18 to 23. Individual score in birth balance score below 45 that indicate the greater risk of falling. The individual with psychiatric causes of cognitive dysfunction plus individual with comorbid physical dysfunction were excluded from this study. Next, tools we used, screening tool, mini mental status examination. The scales to use to identify the people with mild cognitive impairment. Berg balance scale, this scale is used to identify the static and dynamic balance of the participants. Outcome measure is the AC, Addenbrooke's cognitive examination revised. This scale's higher score indicate better cognitive function. Berg balance scale, this is to measure the functional balance. Here use COPM, the scales to use to measure the self-perception of occupational performance in the area of the self-care. Modified COPM beams. Procedure, permission was taken from the institutional aid and consent from the patients. A total of 25 were screened, where 15 participants were selected according to the selection criteria, MMSE and Berg balance scale score. Pre-test assessments were done using ACR revised and Berg balance scale and COPM. Intervention were given for 4 weeks, 12 sessions, 3 days per 3 day per week, 1 hour per session. Each session started off with 5 to 10 minutes of warm up, 30 to 40 minutes with core exercise, and cool down activities for 5 to 10 minutes. And feedback about client performance were also given. Post assessment were taken at the end of the last session. Next here, simulated functional task. It means object placing and collection, following the specific pattern of movement and a sequence incorporated with sit to stand movement performed. Here the 5 levels, including unilateral movement, bimanual movement, and task switching and body midline crossing. These are the level of core movements. Simple place and collection, circular place and collection, alternate place and collection, repeated place and collection, bimanual alternate place and collection. Here we incorporate the ADL tasks according to the level of core movements, the feeding, dressing, grooming, bathing. Here the table shows warm-up activities we give before starting the sessions, neck stretching, shoulder stretching, arm and hand stretching, and leg stretching, and ankle stretching. After we finish the program, we give cool-down activities for calf stretching, upper body stretching, knee raise, and ankle stretch. Here the simulated functional task session planned. First week, we give level 1 and 2. Next week, second week, we give level 2 and 3. Third week, we give level 3 and 4. Next, here the data analysis. So this table represents the 0.00 significance in comparison of pre-test and post-test score of ACR and BPS. This graph shows the mean difference of pre-test and post-test score of ACR and BPS, here indicating the post-test score higher than the pre-test score of experimental group. Here then, this table represents the 0.00 significance of pre-test and post-test score of COPM performance and satisfaction. This graph represents the performance and satisfaction of the mean difference of COPM performance and satisfaction. Post-test score is higher than the pre-test score. Here the discussion discuss the older people with reduced executive function tend to walk slow and more fall more often, have the poor performance on complex mobility tasks. The combination of cognitive and physical activities can bring forth changes in neurogenesis. Here, according to Occupational Therapy Practice Framework, OTPF, the use of meaningful occupation as a mean of therapeutic intervention to promote cognitive function and occupational performance. This study, current study focusing on FCTSIM and its implication of activities of daily living. FCTSIM tasks were prepared according to the level of core movements, incorporating the ADL, which include feeding, bathing, grooming, and dressing. To the current study where participants all showed significant improvement in executive function, functional balance as shown in graph. Here the performance of sequential task in FCTSIM program requires simultaneous maintenance and comparison of information, which can exert the high cognitive demands on central executive control and a successful performance results from the cognitively demanding task, resulting in improved general cognitive function. We got additional feedback received from the participants regarding the FCT SIM program, also support the result of this current study. It shows tremendous improvement in performance and satisfaction of that participants. We concluded this study suggests that the simulated functional task improve executive function, functional balance, and activities of daily living in elderly people with mild cognitive impairment. These are all the my limitations and recommendations. These are all the references. Thank you.
Ma'am, we can go for questions if we have any.
Yeah, please, anyone, any questions? 2 questions are allowed. Audience, anyone wishes to ask? Yeah, please.
There are no questions in the question answer section.
As of now, there are no questions, ma'am, in the question answer session.
Yes. Can we ask?
Yeah, we can. Go ahead, Karun.
Yeah, Sanjeev Kumar, I wanted to know what was the duration of the whole study?
It's 1 month, ma'am. Totally 1 month.
4 weeks.
Yes, ma'am, 4 weeks.
You tested them at beginning of the session and after 4 weeks.
Yes, ma'am. Pre-test and post.
Yeah. Do you feel the need that you should have also tested them after a month or probably after 6 weeks again, just to see whether the learning has really occurred? Or
I didn't check after finishing the sessions. I couldn't have time to check.
Okay. You could have done follow-up.
Yeah, one small thank question. I would just like just a clarification. You talked about warm-up tasks which you gave, you know. So you had timed them or how many counts or for how much, how long each warm-up task was given?
Is nearly before starting the session, I gave only for 5 to 10 minutes, ma'am.
All together, total was 5 to 10 minutes.
Yes, ma'am, 5 to 10 minutes. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Dr. Sarju. He or she is going to talk about gender differences in quality of life and subjective happiness in community dwelling elderly in India. Dr. Sarju, please take over.
The title of my presentation is Gender Differences in Quality of Life and Subjective Happiness in Community Dwelling Elderly in India. This is some of the introduction. Quality of life is defined as the individual perception of the position in life in the context of the culture and value system in which they live and in relation to their goals, expectations, standards, and concern. There is currently an agreement that the construct of QL has a multidimensional character and both objective and subjective components are identified within it. This definition is even more complex if we attempt to conceptualize the QL of elderly individuals. According to the Population Census 2011, there are nearly 104 million elderly persons ages 60 years and above in India, out of which 53 million were females and 51 million males. QL measures can be utilized to monitor disease progress, evaluate treatment, and prioritize problems in clinical practice. Therefore, it is important to determine the overall QL and its related factors among the older adults. Studies have shown that gender plays an essential role in decision making as well as the perception of health and well-being and cultures. Although there have been reports of worse health-related QL among women in developing countries, it is not fully understood what role gender plays in overall QL. With very few studies conducted on the gender disparity in elderly in India, it is necessary to build knowledge based on QL associated with aging in India to increase awareness and improve the quality of the elderly services. Since self-reported happiness and health are now being recognized as 2 critical components of well-being that can inform public policies to promote equality and restore disparities in well-being across the population, this knowledge can help policymakers with the development of social and health programs or interventions to effectively enhance the well-being of their citizens' happiness. As evidence has proved that occupational therapy is a cost-effective healthcare intervention for independent living senior citizens where marked improvements were seen in the quality of life after occupational therapy intervention. Keeping the above facts in view, the present study was planned. This would provide a better understanding of the role of gender in equal quality of life and well-being across different cultures and local ethnic groups. The objective of the study: the study was conducted to assess the differences in quality of life and subjective happiness between male and female community dwelling elderly in India. The methods and the materials used were, this is a cross-sectional survey, and elderly defined by their age greater than or equal to 60 years of age and by living independently of Aizawl, Mizoram, Orisha, and Delhi. In this study, 60 years and above were included as elderly adapted from Newman and Newman's classification of life stages associated developmental tasks and psychological developmental stages by Erickson. 100 subjects in total were contacted. Out of which those children, those elderly with cognitive deficits or who were severely ill or bedridden, participants who could not give informed consent and participants who left during data collection or had filled in incomplete data or those unwilling to participate in the study were excluded. Few of them contacted through mails did not respond within a stipulated time. Hence, the final sample size consisted of 80 participants and 40 from each gender participated. The data was collected by administering the WHO QL, BREF, and SSS scale in person and through mail after getting the due consent. Participation was voluntary and anonymous, and participants were assured of confidentiality, were also informed to assert this right to withdraw at any time. The measures and procedures used were the data related to the socio-demographic variables were collected as per the WHO QOL BREF questionnaire for the present study, including age, sex, social, religion, and marital status. The WHO QRL is a 26 self questionnaire, which consists of four domains, the physical, health, psychological, social, and the environment. There are also two separate questions, WHO QRL 1 and 2, which represents the individual overall perception of health and the individual overall perception of quality of life. And for the subjective happiness scale, it was used by, which was developed by the Leiber, Mirsky, and Leper. It consists of four questions. For the statistical analysis, descriptive statistics were used for the different variables. Data were presented in terms of percentages and mean wherever appropriate. This is the data showing for the mean age of the total population, male 40, female 40. And the age range was 60 to 93, and for female, it was 60 to 83. And in the social demographic details, majority of them were Christians, majority of them went to primary school. The majority of them have the illness, and most of them were from the semi-urban, and most of them were married. In the descriptive analysis, whereas the difference between gender on quality of life and happiness were computed by t-test. For overall quality of life and general health item denominators as 1 and 2, there was no significant difference on these two genders, which was non-significant on t-test. And for the four domain scores, these are the means which were found. For the four domains of WHO QL, the differences in the mean of elderly males and significance were non-significant on t-test, except for domain 4, which is the environment domain, where the difference was significant. Additionally, on pre-test, marital status, married subjects performed better, religion, Hindus better scores than the Christians, and education, higher education scored better, location, subjects with urban areas scored better than semi-urban. Overall, in our study, 6.25% of the total subjects had fair quality of life, 71 had good, and 22 had excellent quality of life. This is a response for the subjective happiness scale. Here also, the test was found non-significant for both the genders. And in this discussion, we found that the global progress has been made in the equality and the empowerment status of women. Substantial evidence from different parts of the world highlighted this study has some interesting findings, which were in localized ethnic gender studies regard to quality of life and well-being. The majority of the participants in the present study were from the suburban region of Aizawl. This is a Christian-dominated state practicing Christianity. The gender gap in literacy as per the census is insignificant in Mizoram. Females were less literate, where females and more educated at tertiary or higher education levels, whereas majority of females had primary and secondary schooling than males. Those residing in urban areas scored better than semi-urban. Christians had better social support relationship as attributed to regular visit church for Sunday mass offering, but therefore providing better opportunity for social contact for elderly. Hence, they scored better in social relationship than those Hindus who are residing urban and well, they scored better in other domains. The present study domain females sought were less healthy. Morbidity, gender status reported morbidity in females were compared to males. Findings regarding domain 2, males scored better. Domain 3 revealed that females scored highly greater to general studies. Despite many higher QL in male comparison, to found no statistical difference in most of the domains. In domain 4, statistical difference was found. In our study, we find that the females were more happy than the males, although there is no significant difference. Happiness, there is a decline in happiness by reported male in comparison with age and moral distress in social relations resulting unhappy feelings. In our study, as women now possess a much higher status in the Mesochristian society, the level of their happiness may have increased with no significant statistical difference in males. Pinkoit and Sorensen have also concluded that although some gender differences were small, they continue to exist in the due to the disadvantage of women. Overall, in our study, as I already said, 71 had good and 22 had excellent.
Sarju, you're running out of time, so just wind up fast.
Okay. So in my conclusion, I would like to add that occupational therapy is very important for the elderly persons. So we can provide occupation based on their needs of the elderly. These are some of my references. Thank you.
I have a few questions. Can we go ahead?
Yes. Yeah, please.
Okay. There's a question. What was your research design and specify the measures of subjective happiness and how the co-founders were taken care of?
Pardon?
What was your research design? And specify...
It is a cross-sectional study.
Okay. And specify the measures of subjective happiness and how the co-founders were taken care of.
The subjective happiness scale which we used was of four questions. It consisted of four questions. Which has a sentence starting from not very happy to very happy. So they have to select from that seven scale for each questions, and the total score represents how, whether they are higher the score, the more the happiness.
Okay. How normality of data distribution, sorry.
Actually, we have just used the convenient sampling.
Okay, how normality of data distribution was established?
Sorry, I could not get that.
How the normality of data distribution was established? Okay, we'll move on to the next question. What is the implication of this study for occupational therapy practice?
In our study, we have found that most of the elderly have scored less in the social relationship area. So OT can focus more on the, like, how to make the elderly more active in the social relationship.
Okay, ma'am.
Dr. Murli, can I just make a comment for Sarju?
Yes, ma'am.
Sarju, I mean, I don't know how you have selected the gender different, that is the males and the females, but don't you think if they are from the same environment, like if they are husband and wife, you know, you take them together as one, the male and female from the same family, you would get a better result because the environment is the same. So probably it will have a better inference than taking at random males and females. This was what I feel, my suggestion.
Yeah. Yeah, ma'am, sure. That is a very good inclusion of the sample. Go for further study on that.
You can try on that.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. I think Karuna can proceed now.
Okay, so Dr. Chetan is going to speak about effectiveness of action observation dual task training on balance and its impact on activities of daily living among elderly population. Over to you, Dr. Chetan.
Good morning, everyone. My title of the study is like effectiveness of action observation, dual task training on balance and its impact on activities daily living among elderly population. In background, worldwide, there is, in particularly India, elderly population is increasing rapidly over the year. And by 2000 to 2050, it will be double and it will be like almost 11 to 22% increase. And balance disturbances are common occurrence with increasing age and have significant impact on living on the older adult. Age-related changes in sensory motor and neuromuscular system will also negative effect on the static and dynamic postural control even in healthy older adults. Activity daily living require balance maintenance and independence in ideally is crucial for successful aging. and due to these physiologic changes, include loss of balance due to aging, lead to loss of physical function dependent on assistance in performing activity daily living. Major activity daily living are dual tasks, which is required two or more tasks to perform it. And performance dual tasks in old age contribute to decline in physical and cognitive decline. An older adult who receive balance training under dual task condition should benefit in dual task training, which is maintained over a period of 3 months. And our action observation therapy is developing neuro-rehabilitative tool, which is based on existing mirror neural system. This neural network involves motor region, which facilitate during execution and as well as during observation of the same action. Evidence proved that action observation is beneficial in elderly subjects, improving balance deficits. And also, many report study was the loss of balance and high risk of falls in older people are directly proportional aging, leads to physical deficit and depend on assistance in performing ADLs. Further, majority elderly sustain falls as a result of their difficulty in executing cognitive postural tasks simultaneously. And balance training program for dual tasks with increased difficulty shifting priority between two tasks help improve balance and functional recovery. Exception therapy improves arm and hand motor function performance in daily activities found in 2015. Also, when we are giving activities close to the ADL, then it will be more effective, which is studied done by Evan and Holmes. And need to address balance deficit has a hindrance ADL performance and independence, which therefore become prime importance. There are studies evaluated the role of action position with dual task training on cognitive deficit, but there is no studies which assess the effectiveness of action position with dual task training for motor deficit like balance and its impact on ADL performance. Occupational therapy research aims to contribute to the development of knowledge in this area, and the study has been taken to examine the action position dual task training on balance, rehabilitation, and its impact on ADL among elderly population. Aim of the study was to find out the effect of action observation dual task training on balance among elderly, and second was to find the impact of action observation dual task training on ADL among elderly. The studies objective of the study was to estimate the score pre and post dose balance and ADL within the control group experimental group, and to compare pre-test post balance score between the control experimental group, and to compare pre-test and post-test score ADL score between in the experimental group. My hypothesis was null hypothesis was there is no significant difference in elderly dual task training on balance in the elderly population. There is no major difference in action observation dual task training among ADL performance in elderly population. Alternative hypothesis was there is significant difference in action observation dual task training on balance among elderly population. There is significant difference in action observation dual task training among elderly population. On methodology, my ethical clearance got from the ethical committee, SRM Medical College Research Center. I use the study design of quasi-experimental pre-post study design. I use non-probability convenience sampling. I selected 42 older adults, which is selected in experimental 21 and control group in 21. I selected from the Kutan Kladar community. Inclusion criteria were older adult age 60 and above, both male and female. Bulk balance score should be more than 21. Minimum shoulders more than 24, ambulation without no assistance, a good visual acuity and without a correct lens, and patient with good auditory comprehension. Exclusion criteria was history of neuromuscular, no history of neurological history, muscular psychiatry. If there, then I will exclude that client. Use instrument, minimum status and the Bergman scale as a screening tool. And the outcome measure I use for balance, I use Bergman scale, time of go test and functional test. And for ADL, I use modified Bartholin index. These are the material equipment I use for my study. Data collection procedure, ethical clearance I got, then selected parties on the selection criteria, screening to administer. Then I explain the purpose of the and consent form was given. Who expected consent form, then I use did measure, which is Bergman scale, FRT, DUG, MBR. Where after that, I started my intervention. So before starting with the intervention, I selected 8 activities, 8 dual task activities, functional dual activities, which I pre-recorded on the left, on the 60 years old male. And I pre-recorded that video and saved on the laptop. Then during intervention, first I will show them that video and they have to perform that. So in experimental group, I will give action observation plus dual task training, that is 8 sessions, 3 times a week, for 3 weeks, for 35 minutes each. And control group, I'm only giving dual task training. So 10 minutes they have to observe that video, and then 25 minutes they have to practice. And a post-test measure I use the Bergman scale by FRT, TVG, and MBR. These are the activities I use: walking in the figure of eight, including swimming on not pulled, walk backward in zipping and sitting, walking circle, three obstacle crossing while bouncing ball on the floor. So these are the each session I use one activities. And on data analysis, I use comparison with pre-post test score in control and experimental group. On the control group, I found there was a statistical difference in the pre and post test score, where only FRT was not significant, which I discussed in discussion. And experimental group, all the variables was significant with p-value less than 0.01. These are the independent t-test scores compared between the group this analysis, where I found in pre-test there was no significance, but in post-test I got statistical difference in the all the outcome measures, where p-value was less than in experimental group mean difference was more than the control group. This consisted of current study established positive effect extrapolation dual task screening on balance in experimental group, where the result of this study agreed to the conducted in theta many, which is concluded the AOT is beneficial for balance rehabilitation. Substantial difference in both the Bergmann-Lesson and Hughes dynamics in the dynamic balance in control group, and was observed where FRT was not significant difference because it has agreed to previously conduct study in New Michigan. The effect of dual task training on the elderly showed there was no significant difference in FRT among the control group because it is a maximum static stability. The secondary aim was to estimate the difference in the MBR score, which was also significant in current study after administration. This is that agreed to study previously conducted by assess the significant difference in ADL score assessed by the on Barthel and Fugelmeier assessment. In between the group analysis found all the outcome measure was the significant, which will mark improvement in balance after extrapolation dual task training, and performance function has also significant improvement with the dual task. Agreed to previous study conducted in the discussion 2-4, additional number of observations were made, that is the experimental group there was less verbal and physical cue than the control group, and the ultimate of the study was to enhance preparation for motor planning, prior preparation about the movement as well as the task in elderly through the observation therapy and dual task training for improving their balance and performance everyday tasks. These are the limitation time constraint of the intervention. Selection of sample done through a convenient sampling, follow-up analysis was not carried out, and in clinical implication study nurtured the knowledge of exam observation to as a crucial intervention as matter to the management balance issue in elderly. Extravasation therapy aids to improve balance efficiency in elderly, thereby facilitating their performance activity and the daily living skill. Extravasation is feasible and simple to apply in clean setting. Phone is user-friendly, and nowadays almost of the older adults are using. It is easy to store the video of daily tasks, which is difficult on phone, and watch it later and can practice it. Conclusion, the effect daily under the NS multi-task cognitive performance. Thus, effectiveness of extravasation with dual task training enhance balance rehabilitation and impact activity living performance in elderly, and occupational intervention to enhance healthy aging and promote active rehabilitation is thus the prime aim of geriatric rehabilitation. Recorded similar study can be carried out with the large sample size. Recording video of daily tasks, which is difficult for the client, can be used as a home program along with the care supervision. These are the
references. You have 2 minutes. Okay.
These are my acknowledgement to Dr. Sundaram and Ganapati Shankar, SRM College of OT, Dr. Silpa Imale, my mentor, also my participant, and to my Dr. Asim Bandekar and Dr. Vivek for participating in voting on 2021. Thank you.
Do we have any question for Dr. Chetan?
Ma'am, as of now, there are no questions in the question answer section.
Okay. Dr. Chetan, I had one question for you.
Yes, ma'am.
In your discussion, it looks more like you have written your results, that what you found, but you have not discussed why it has, found right. Like this. So could you please elaborate on that?
On which, sir? This thing, sir, within the groups, ma'am?
Yeah.
On my study, I got after intervention, I found both the group was shown improvement, which is dual task group, which is control group, I give only dual task intervention. And in experimental group, I give extravasation plus dual task training intervention, where intervention, post-test score was increased in both the group, but there was a mean difference was there, which is more in experimental group than compared to the control group.
Yes, so why? That is what I want to know. Why?
Because because experimental group, the positive effect was that they get chance to see the video, which is like, what is the motor response they have to do after that. So they get that opportunity, which they can observe, and then they can practice that same task, particular task. And also for dual task, it is like directly they have to perform. They don't know what they have to perform. Only I'll explain them.
Okay.
This was done in spite of your inclusion criteria. You had said that you had that the Berg balance scale should have so many points, all those things you have mentioned. So in spite of that, you found this difference, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Any more questions for Dr. Chetan?
No more questions here in the question section.
Okay. So we move on to our next presenter.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Chetan. Yeah. Okay, our next presenter is Dr. Parag Arsul. His topic of presentation is developing of occupational therapy ADL index to assess basic activities of daily living in Indian context. Over to you, Dr. Parag Arsul.
Good morning, all of you. Okay, my title of my study is developing the occupational therapy ADL index to assess the basic ADL activity of daily living in the Indian context. Okay, introduction. We know, it's one of the important domain of the occupational therapies and the occupational therapies activity of daily living. The following are the consideration we analyze the ADLs. That's always be a client factors, performance skills, performance patterns, what kind of the habits and the rituals they have. We always see the environment, physical and the social environment, and always we consider the client contextual frameworks as per the OTPF. So ADL instrument has been designed to support the client center and occupational focus approach and relevant to the client's everyday life and to promote the focus of the quality of ADL performance, not just only for the assistance. Can we use the across the clients, target groups, clinical settings, and we have to try to maximize the how they are performing the ADL abilities. We always generate valid and the reliable measures to quality of ADL task perform. And that tool has to be sensitive enough to able to document the changes in the client's overall ADL task performance. Overall, we are using the independent and dependent and the assistants are the most commonly used terminologies. And we assess them as a scientifically. Note that difference of the parameters are ADL like values, interest, scope up, behavior, adequacy will always be neglected. They are important when we assess patient as a whole. So the purpose of the study is to develop the new ADL occupational therapy index to evaluate the parameters to understand the patient's daily life skills. The objective of the study were to determine the various parameters in relation to the ADL activities and to investigate how these parameters view each ADL items relative to its importance to the patient. These are the commonest ADL parameters I included in my study, that is values, okay. Then MOHO, according to the MOHO, how much the satisfaction, interest, and the personal causation will be included. The coping, how they can cope up with the means exactly the solve the personal and the interpersonal problems and minimize the stress and the conflict. Safety is a very important thing which has to be whenever we are engaged in the activity. Satisfaction is the experience of the pleasure and the willingness to engage has to be important. And how they are directly participate and how they experience about their skills and habits in the ADL, that is very important. That's what we certain questionnaires, we will develop certain questions. That is how much it is independence is important to you. Are you able to perform the activity same as before? Do you believe in the activity? Are you able to cope up with the activity? There's a satisfaction of the completion of the activity is there. And then usual parameters are the time, which is always activity has to be complete in a reasonable time. Efficacy is that is what the difficulty in pain, fatigue and dyspnea and duration is always the ADL, ADL activities. And the level of independence, non-physical help, and the physical assistance, which is we are commonly used. So under the normative standard, satisfaction, experience, and the aberrant activity behavior always be noted during the all the ADL task performances. So again, the last 10 questions we have on, they are able to perform within normal time. They are independent, partially dependent, or the dependent. Difficulty in doing non-physical assistance and the physical assistance. We follow that hierarchical model to understand the difficulty levels in the ADLs. Methodology, the study is designed with the prospective qualitative study and development of the new skills. We have taken the ADL as a dependent variable and age and sex is an independent variable. This is my phase one, phase two, and the phase three, how we are gone to the development of this instrument. The phase one, we have done the item generations. We consider the many of the skills like a FIM, Barthel index, which is a standardized gold standards. We have always used the COPM, various indexes, AMPS to understand the taking the relevant and the try to take the adaptability from those. And we are incorporating the some kind of the items in the new skills. We have extensive gone into the review of literature to develop our parameters and the component of the new skill. We have developed the 10 components basically, which is our basic ADL activities, that is feeding, grooming, bathing, toilet activity, dressing upper limb, dressing lower limb, bed mobility, transfer in the bed and the chair and the back, walking, and the stair use, which is the commonest one. Okay. We have scoring system of 3-point scoring. It is from the 0 to 2. 0 considers the independent or the most of the difficulty. 2 is a dependent, that is a more difficulty. Okay. And the maximum score consists of the 200 and the minimum score consists of 0 and the total score of the 20 of the each 10 parameters. all attempts are formulated specifically single ideas with the single ideas to prevent any kind of the confusion. The phase two, we develop the tool and the scale. Okay. The format, understanding the flow of the scale, assess the basic ideal activities in the subjects. The scale has to be developed, reviewed by the 5 experts at the, from the various field of the occupational therapy. After reviewing them and their suggestions, we have changed in the certain kind of the items and the rating in the scales. The further is a quantitative, we have developed the phase 3 as a pilot study conducted in the 100 subject, which including the neurological conditions like a stroke patients. We have included stroke patient only. We included the adult and the geriatric population range from the 20 to 75. We keep the long range. We exclude the patient with the understanding and comprehension problems and unwilling to participate in the study. The subject were explained about the study objective and informed consent was taken, okay, with the proper ethics committee approval. Okay. So demographic information including age, gender, marital status, living situation recorded into the medical information relative to their conditions. Developed the scale was administered responsibly recorded. Time of the administration also recorded. Later the data will be analyzed for the psychometric properties. Data analysis and the result. The total number of the cases are the 58 females and the males are 42. We have differently age group, we have defined it 20 to 30, 30 to 40, 40 to 50, and 50 to 60, 60 to 70, which always mentioned in the graph. Okay. This is what the gender ratio and the age ratio we have mentioned in the demographic information. The psychometric properties of the skills, the content validity of the scale was scrutinized and the review by the 5 experts from the various field of the occupational therapy. Working in the different institute, then the final version of the OT index was developed. The reliability and the internal consistency of the OT index is a KR. We are a Kunder and the Richardson's 220 we have used it, that is indicating 0.97. It is a higher internal consistency. Internal consistency varied from the 0.78 to 0.85 for the various of the parameters and the scales. The mean value of the internal consistency is 0.8326. Okay, and it is a correlation and the consistency is shown. The test and the retest reliability was 0.87. That is intra-class correlation coefficient from the day one and the post-test with after the 15th day. These are the mean score and the internal consistency component from the feeding, grooming, bathing, dressing, upper limb, lower limb, toilet activity, bed mobility, and the transfers of bed to chair and the back and the walking and stair use. Okay, stair use is the maximum mean value and the feeding is the lowest mean value. A discussion in using the ADL as a domain of the occupational therapist, the therapist need to be aware about the different terminologies and the concept of the daily living activities. As per the different skills, standardized assessment skills available, the concept of understanding the ADL is changing over the time. So standardized assessment and the certain limitations are evaluating, understand the various operation and the concept of ADL. Consider together all these things, the traditional instrument used to evaluate the ADL based on the assistance can be become inadequate for the
document. You have 2 minutes left, Chetan. Parag, sorry.
As there the risk of the ceiling effect and the floor effects and the lack of sensitivity, okay, create the risk of being the documented and they improve the quality of task performance. So perhaps we are try to consecutively be critical the use of the instrument covering the broad range of the ADL tasks to enable the occupational therapist to evaluate nature of the extent from the ADL task performance problem. Discriminate between the levels of the ADL ability, document the changing the among the clients very high to the low level of the ADL activity. Such instrument therefore must be designed to consider the other aspect besides the assistance and related to the ADL task performance time, physical and the safety. So we have evaluated the values and the independence, safety and the quality. It is need to be inside into the this and the purpose of the this scale has to be understanding the values, adequacy, safety, standard, and the finally acceptability by the patient. 10 parameters we have evaluated. We observe the patient has a difficulty responding the few questions. There's a need to be translate the skill in a different local language due to the language barrier. Our tool is help to understand the hierarchy of the deficits from the starting from value, standard, adequacy, efficacy, difficulty, non-physical, and the physical assistance. Research and the clinical implication. The scale is learned to learn about the patient's activity performance based on the client's need and the preferences. And it is easy to screen out the ADL activity detail with respect to the decision-making and intervention outcome. Finally, it will be a facilitate the client-centeredness, that is what they wish to do, what they are required to do, and what they are expected to do. The conclusion, the study indicates the was a good reliability. Okay, facilitates the OT index objective for the domain in the contributor significantly in the activity limitations, may contribute to OT practice and the research in India. Recommended the future reliability and the validity testing on the specific diagnosis and the require the future cooperation with the various existing skills with the assess the ideal
skills. Your time is up, Chin.
This is my acknowledgement. These are my references. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Parag. You have two questions.
Yeah.
How it is different from existing measures of ADL in Indian context, and what were the strategies followed to overcome geographical location variation?
Okay. The whatever that we are using, like a FEAM and the Barthel index, is more of related to the understanding the not exactly about the only the independence or dependent, how much the physical assistance and the assistance is required. But we as occupational therapists, we need to understanding what it is really valuable for them. They are really interesting such kind of the activities or no. Sometimes is a specific to that Indian context is some kind of the activities they are not interested at. So then certain conditions, yeah. Hello, ma'am.
Please go ahead.
Yeah. So in certain conditions, we need to understand the hierarchical level of the activity to be understood. Rather than completely RE, it is independent to, it is dependent. It is it very independent and dependent only assistance. It is really valuable for them. They are interested. They have any kind of the more difficulties because difficulty level are not mentioned in the many of the skills. They have the difficulty because of the some kind of the tonal issues, because of the contracture or because of these things. And that as we are limited to that context. So that's what it is a motivation to put all these things, because we have to, again, we have to use a 3-4 standardized skill like a COPM, then interest checklist, then the Barthel index and otherwise the FEAM. So again, that is a time consuming. So it is a one tool we have to try to generate like that. It can be understanding the overall ideas of the patients and the, what the patient's requirement. Again, it's a client center and occupational focus we have to be there. So many of the skills are not a OT point of view. There are many point of view, the only for the ADL. So as an occupational therapist, we need to be think about these are the areas. So that is what the motivation and that is what the contest will be here.
Okay. Ma'am, if the chat doesn't have a question, we have one more question.
Go ahead.
You can go ahead, then I'll comment.
Okay. Dr. Parag, what was the sensitivity and specificity, and highlight your ROC curve?
ROC curve. Okay. So this is just a pilot study I'm trying to tell you, but we are just making a more of sensitization and we are checking in the more into the more population and we are going in the detail of that. It is just one of the part of that we are trying to be explain it and put it in the for the presentations. Okay.
Okay, Dr. Parag.
Yeah, can I just, I think two questions are done. Can I just make a small comment? Yes, this was, I appreciate your efforts in doing something novel. Very good. But then one thing I wanted to know, you have included in this, even the stroke, and then you're taking the aged also. So did you have any, why did you do this? It will be more difficult for you to...
That is what, ma'am, it is a geriatric population always have a certain kind of the stroke and the, we have to be consider both. Initially, we are open with the everything. We have not keep anything. So now I have taken the only the part of the stroke patient and I'm trying to present that. It is for the geriatric patients. We have completely taken the stroke patient, head injury. Even we are taking for the ortho cases like upper limb fractures, lower limb fractures. We are trying to segregate.
Now, are you doing them separately or are you doing them all together?
We are together, but we have making a separate part of it to understanding the homogeneity of that population and understanding what kind of the problems we are facing when we are dealing with them.
Good idea.
Thank you, Parag.
Yeah.
We move on to our next speaker, who is Dr. Avira Shetty. He is talking about, I want to visit a library too, reimagining libraries with children with disabilities and their caregivers to promote participation. Over to you, Dr. Raviraj.
As you can see that before I start my presentation, I would like to invite you who is listening to this presentation to think about libraries. And when you think of libraries, who do you think of access as a library? Who do you see around you? You know, who are the people? And if you've ever been to a children's library, to look around to see what children visit libraries and how accessible libraries are. The topic of my presentation is I want to visit a library to reimagining libraries with disabled children. Reimagining libraries with disabled children and their caregivers to promote participation. I'm Dr. Raviraj Shetty. I'm a lead occupational therapist and project manager at Umeed. I'm a certified library educator. And as I'm sharing, I would want you to meet Puchku, who is on the left-hand side in the corner. Puchku is a character from a book that I love, and she's going to tell her story alongside me. Children's libraries equip children with lifelong learning skills, empower them to advocate for their freedom and safety, contribute to their literacy and language development, and also allows them to exercise their agency. And access to libraries is a right of every child, including disabled children. But accessibility is a fundamental to concept foundation of a library. Unfortunately, disabled children very commonly experience difficulties in participating. What does occupational marginalization look like within libraries? Is libraries are basically able-bodied designed. There is a significant lack of representation in children's literature. There's lack of awareness of disabled children's needs. There's negative attitudes and lack of understanding about disability. Leisure is not a priority for disabled children, and most of the books are able-bodied designed. So occupational marginalization within librarying as an occupation is because of the environment and not because of the disability. So we decided to study factors influencing participation of disabled children and their caregivers in librarying as an occupation. How did we go about it? We decided to do a qualitative descriptive research design. We set up a library in the waiting area of a child development center, which was running bi-weekly for 6 weeks. We collected data through observation, maintaining a field diary, and unstructured interviews. We did convenience sampling. Children and families were visiting the center for therapy and consults. We did consent and shared about the study and answered all the queries that families and children had. How did we go about designing the library? So before we started the study, we spent time designing the library. So as an occupational therapist, I use the knowledge of ergonomics, accessibility, environmental modification, and my understandings of child development and developmental disabilities. We interviewed families and children and therapists and library educators and architects to gather information what would an accessible library look like. Used my knowledge as a library educator and found a space which was wheelchair accessible. We constructed the bookshelves. We collaborated with an architect. We designed it using standard measurements of reach for a pediatric wheelchair, which means every corner of the bookshelf can be reached by sitting on a wheelchair. Books were arranged based on demand in the reading level from bottom to top, like the bottom ones didn't have script to the top ones which had more script. We colored the background off-white and had dark colored holding strips to promote participation of children with visual perceptual difficulties. We curated the collection of the books and made books accessible. So collection had books which were interactive books about cars and dinosaurs. We found that from the interview, books made of photographs from real scenarios, books which had stories of disabled children. We modified books by adding textures, depth, sensorial elements, and thick cardboard bindings to hold. We had a tablet, which had soft copies, and an app. We also set up interactive activities for families and professionals in the organization based on the books, the results. So we had a field project diary where I would note down all the observations that I was observing, verbatim unstructured interviews with children and families. We had 20 participants. The collected data was analyzed and organized into 7 themes that emerged through inductive reasoning. The first theme was reducing physical barriers. And I'm going to share snippets from the diary. A 2-year-old boy with Down syndrome learning to sit independently was brought by his father. His father made him sit on his hand so that the child could look at the books. He was drawn to the images of the cover page of Mala's Silver Anklet on the bookshelf. He tapped on it and it fell down. So his dad picked the book and sat in a corner reading the book to him. A girl in a wheelchair came in looking for a book with magic stories. She browsed through the collection, sitting comfortably on her wheelchair, and found a book for herself. She maneuvered the wheelchair in a quiet corner and started reading. A mother of a 5-year-old expressed, "It's so good to see that the books are front-facing and are not overlapping each other. It's so easy to see them and for my child to choose because she usually gets overwhelmed by clutter." theme two that emerged was context-informed collection. We observed that children engaging with books for the first time were choosing board books with touch, sound, and feel components. We also noticed it was much easier to hold books which were thicker. Having books with minimal print script supported by illustrations prompted engagement of children with learning difficulties and intellectual disability. When a parent noticed a book with a disabled child as a protagonist of the story, he said, "This is the first time I'm reading a story where a disabled child is shown with so much respect." Theme three that emerged was opportunities to engage with books. Many families expressed how this was the first time their child is engaging with books. They also expressed that they thought their child was never interested in books. Some families noticed that their children were not interested in books, but were more interested in toys around. But when they saw other kids engaging, they expressed that it might be possible that their kid might also show interest someday if they keep showing them books. Caregivers is an extension of children's bodies. A four-year-old experiencing autism visited the library a week before. He sat and played with toys, but didn't engage with the collection. The following week, he was doing the same thing, but this time his father picked up a book from the collection. He sat next to his son and opened the book. He moved the cat's tail and its eyes, which got the little boy's attention. And this started an engagement with the books for the next 15 minutes. Afterwards, the father went back and sat at a distant chair. The child started to independently browse for books and look through them. Theme five, toys and playful environment. Many children stepped into the library on their own to play with toys and slowly engage with the books. One of them sat for something, one of them was making blocks of small towers, and the parents then made books towers with of board books, and was a kid with Down syndrome and tumbled the tower, and the book that fell open was the one that the parents were reading to the child. Theme six is interactive activities. A 10-year-old with dyslexia spent 40 minutes in the library after her therapy session solving the quiz. Her dad was surprised and expressed, "I've never seen her engage with these books intently. She seems to enjoy the solving the quiz." When asked what must be the reason, he said, "Maybe it's because there are pictures along with text that's holding her attention." Engaging professionals and support staff. One occupational therapist conducted 15 minutes of a session with a child in the library. She was working towards developing visual perceptual skills, thus played I Spy with the images on the bookshelf, and continued her work on auditory attention through reading a book chosen by the child. The discussion focused on practices that promoted participation, consulting the consultants on accessibility. One of the most important practices that emerges as must while engaging with construction of library is to consult those for whom the library is for. Nothing about us without us is a term that evolved from disability justice movement, which advocates that disabled people to be the center of the conversation. Modifying and reimagining environments. Addressing not just physical barriers, but attitudinal barriers of caregivers and professionals become important influencers. Many research studies indicate attitude of professionals and caregivers as a major barrier for disabled children to participate in libraries and policies more inclusive towards library making. Scaffolding was the third practice that we noticed common throughout all themes. As we scaffold children and families participate—
Abhiraj, you have just 1 minute to go. Can you summarize? Yeah.
Into the worlds of books, which were very often in our context new and unknown, it's helpful to start from a place of what's known and familiar to what's possible to know. So independent browsing or familiar pictures or toys were familiar environments. Conclusion, the findings of this exploratory study clearly identifies that disabled children can engage with libraries if libraries are made accessible. This study is laying down practices for disabled children library work. Studies with rigorous study designs need to be done. Post this study, 6 months later, we now have a fully functioning library at Umeed because we had some evidence, and it runs on Tuesdays and Fridays as a response to COVID lockdown opening a little bit. These are my references, and thank you.
Thank you, Raviraj. We have a question for you. The question is, what were the functional activities you gave to children in the library?
So one of the activities that we had, so there's a book called The Hungry Caterpillar. And the book is a story of a caterpillar who loves to eat a lot of things. So what we did was we made a caterpillar out of a cardboard. And there were all the things that the caterpillar eats, the apple, the pear, the... So the children would feed the caterpillar and the mother, usually there was an eating session where the mother would feed the same thing to the child too. So this was one, and there were many other activities that were part of the program.
There is one more question.
Can you tell us how would a two-year-old child be needing a library? Is one of the questions.
A two-year-old child can also access library because library has many roles. One is the access to books. Two-year-olds should be shown books and images. When they listen to language and when they listen to words, their receptive language or their dictionary of words increases. It's a great opportunity. The second is that libraries are space for leisure. Many a times parents are running from one therapy session to other therapy session to schools and so much of work. It becomes a space of calm. It becomes a space of leisure where there are no much expectations from families. So there are many things that libraries can play a role for a two-year-old child with Down syndrome.
Thank you.
So any of your books have the phonetics and all in that?
Yes. There is a beautiful app called Story Weaver, which also reads books to children and families.
Very good.
Had any audio books in your library?
Yeah, so we had a tablet which had the Story Weaver app, which has most of the Pratham books in it. So.
Okay. So I guess, thank you, Raviraj.
Thank you.
Good presentation.
Okay, now we move on to our last speaker, last paper of the session. It is Dr. Noor Mohammed. The topic of presentation is correlation among cognitive functions, mood disturbance, and health-related quality of life in type 2 diabetes mellitus patients, a cross-sectional survey. So over to you, Dr. Noor Mohammed.
Thank you, ma'am. And the title of my presentation is correlation among cognitive functions, mood disturbance, and health-related quality of life in type 2 diabetes mellitus patient, a cross-sectional survey study. The type 2 diabetes mellitus is associated with the rapid fluctuations in blood glucose, change in blood glucose concentration, and rapidly affects the cerebral functions. The adverse effect of acute hypoglycemia on cognitive functions and on mood are well recognized. Health-related quality of life measures can demonstrate the impact of health on quality of life. Clinical significance. Type 2 diabetes mellitus is a common metabolic disease. It is characterized by hyperglycemia caused by insulin resistance and an inadequate compensation in secretion of insulin. It may cause various complications like kidney failure, foot ulcer, peripheral neuropathy, and blindness. Type 2 diabetes mellitus is associated with a high risk of cardiovascular disease and premature death. It has become increasingly evident that diabetes may also affect the central nervous system, a complication referred to as diabetic encephalopathy. This complication is reflected in impaired cognitive functioning and is also associated with an increased risk of dementia. Cognitive functioning is compromised in multiple cognitive domains such as memory, information processing speed, language, visual construction, perception, attention, and executive functions, which can be impaired selectively. Many studies on the effect of type 2 diabetes mellitus on cognitive functioning assessed memory function. Studies reported cognitive decline in verbal memory for patients with type 2 diabetes mellitus. Attention has also been examined in many studies. The majority of cross-sectional studies that measures the executive functioning showed diminished performance of the patients. Information processing speed and reaction time in majority of cross-sectional studies shows diminished performance in patients. Moderate impairment across all the cognitive domain was found. Studies have shown the relationship between diabetes and the psychiatric disorders. Recent survey showed that the prevalence of depression is approximately 10% higher in diabetic patients. Chronic hypercortisolemia may lead to insulin resistance, which could explain the association between diabetes mellitus and depression and vice versa. Diabetic patient with depression and associated with poor glycemic control, more complication of diseases, a reduced quality of life, and increased mortality. studies have showed a higher prevalence of the depressive episodes, recurrent depressive episodes, dysthymia, mood disorder with psychotic symptoms and suicidal ideation. There is a growing interest to influence the aspect of quality of life, such as mental health and general well-being. The effect of overall quality of life is well established in general population and have been analyzed in various dimensions, including physical and social functioning, subjective well-being, emotion and mood, self-esteem, self-perception, and cognitive performance and sleep quality. Objective of the study was to find the a possible correlation among cognitive function, mood disturbances, and health-related quality of life in patients with type 2 diabetes mellitus. And the rationale was to understand a relationship between all these variables and to find the impact of mood disturbances on cognitive function and mood disturbance and cognitive function on quality of life with type 2 diabetes mellitus patients. Methodology, the study design was a cross-sectional survey study. Sampling type was convenience sampling. Target population was type 2 diabetes mellitus patients. Sample size was 40 participants. Source of data was the residential society. Inclusion criteria, diagnosed participants with type 2 diabetes mellitus, both male and females were included, and age ranging between 35 years to 55 years, and random blood glucose level 200 mg per dl or above, and the history of type 2 diabetes mellitus for minimum 2 years. Exclusion criteria, type 1 diabetes mellitus patients were excluded, and the blood glucose level below than 200 mg per dl were excluded, and also the patients with the history less than of 2 years of type 2 diabetes mellitus were excluded. Outcome measures which was used was mini mental state examination for the cognitive functions. Mini mental state examination is a 30-point questionnaire that is used extensively in clinical and research setting to measure the cognitive impairment. It is also used to estimate the severity and progression of cognitive impairment and to follow the course of cognitive changes in an individual over time, thus making it an effective way to document an individual's response to treatment. For the mood disturbances, profile of mood state, POMS, was used. It is a widespread instrument which measures the mood. It includes 65 items which load on 7 different scales: depression, anxiety, fatigue, vigor, irritability, tension, and confusion. The response scale is divided into 5 categories ranging from not at all to very strong. For the health-related quality of life, EQ-5D-5L scale was used. It is an instrument comprises a short descriptive system questionnaire and a visual analog scale. The EQ was provide an alternative way to elicit the individual's rating of their own overall current health. The EQ-5D-5L descriptive system comprises 5 dimensions: mobility, self-care, usual activity, pain, discomfort, anxiety, depression. Each dimension now has 5 response level: no problem, slight problem, moderate problem, severe problem, and extreme problem. Procedure of the study was: written consent was taken from all the participants. Demographic data was recorded, like blood glucose, height, weight, BMI. Then the score for the MMSE, POMS, EQ-5D-5L was recorded, and all the collected data was statistically analyzed. Collected data was arranged in the form of master chart made on MS Excel 2007, and SPSS software 20 was used for the Pearson correlation, and significance level was kept at less than 0.05. These table 1 showing the descriptive analysis of the gender, age, BMI, and duration of diabetes, and table 2 showing the male versus female participants. There were 27 female participants and 13 male participants. Table 3 is showing the descriptive analysis of all the variables: blood glucose level, cognitive function, mood disturbance, and health related quality of life. Table 4 is showing the correlation scores between all the variables. Results of the study. Data collected was statistically analyzed, and following results were found. There was significant negative correlation between mood disturbance and cognitive functions, with the value of R minus 0.45 and P less than 0.05. There was non-significant positive correlation between cognitive function and health-related quality of life with the examiner score, and value of R was 0.29 and P was equals to 0.06. Significant positive correlation between cognitive function and health-related quality of life self-score was found, and R value was 0.37 and P was less than 0.05. There was significant negative correlation between mood disturbance and health-related quality of life with the examiner score, with the R value of minus 0.66 and P was less than 0.001. And there was also a significant negative correlation between mood disturbance and health-related quality of life with the participant's self-score, with the value of R is equals to minus 0.62 and P was less than 0.001. These are the scatter diagrams showing the correlation between the cognition and mood disturbance, which is showing you the significant negative correlation. Figure 2 scatter diagram showing the correlation between cognition and quality of life with the examiner score with the non-significant positive correlation. In figure 3, it is showing the significant positive correlation between cognition and participant self-score. Figure 4 is showing the correlation between mood disturbance and quality of life examiner score with the significant negative correlation. Figure 5 showing the also showing the significant negative correlation between mood disturbance and participant self-score. Discussion. Of the study,
you have 2 minutes only.
Significant negative correlation between the mood disturbance and cognitive function shows that the increase in mood disturbance and cognitive functions are significantly deteriorating, and non-significant positive correlation between cognitive function and health-related quality of life shows the participants with impaired cognitive function has reduced quality life. Other results shows that the increased mood disturbance may adversely affect the quality of life with the type 2 diabetes mellitus patients. Conclusion, mood disturbance in the patients with type 2 diabetes mellitus may adversely affect the cognitive functions. Cognitive dysfunctions and mood disturbance are important factors which may influence the various aspects of quality of life. It is important to assess and find the opportunities to reduce the cognitive dysfunctions and mood disturbances with type 2 diabetes mellitus patients to achieve the high quality of life. These are the limitations in which the subjects were taken from the limited sites. Data collected or study was limited from the geographical reach. The study was one-time survey study that would not track the change in blood glucose level, and it should be done to find the level of deterioration in the cognitive function, mood disturbance, health-related quality of life with the time. These are the references. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Noor Mohammed. Do we have any questions? Okay. We have a question for you. How did you establish that mood disturbances are due to diabetes mellitus type 2 and not a personality trait? Also, highlight sample size estimation and normality of data distribution.
So this question has two questions in it.
Yes, for the sample size, that it was a convenience sampling, and depending on the availability of the patients, according to the inclusion criteria, it was like only 40 participants which was found, and definitely it is not we cannot say that the mood disturbance were directly associated with the type 2 diabetes mellitus, but we have found in our study as inferential analysis that with the increase in with the increased history of diabetes, there are increased mood disturbances with the type 2 diabetes mellitus patients.
We have one more question for you. What is the implication of this study in OT practice?
Yes, in the OT practice, that we know that we are following, we try to focus on the person, environment and occupation, and try to use the holistic approach in our practices. So definitely the various factors which are affecting the quality of life of any patient, one should consider that in the treatment part. So if the mood disturbances and the cognitive decline is a major part which is affecting the quality of life, so one should consider these areas also in the treatment strategies.
Oh. I think we have come to the end of the session.
Yes.
Just a small summary I'll do, and Karuna, you can take over then. Okay. It was... a good start. We started with Dr. Nathan talking more on agelessness, and I think the same way went through in all the sessions, in all the presentations. And this goes very well with Clark saying in 2012, where he referred occupational therapy practitioners as architects of life. OT goes far beyond activities of daily living, addresses overall life management, including health promotion and balance within all contexts. Same way, similarly, O'Sullivan in 2011 commented that occupational therapy practitioners, they help older adults maintain independence by incorporating new health routines into old routines. So I thank all the presenters. You have gone ahead of ADL. And I think we must now, as someone mentioned also, that the mortality rate or the age lifespan has increased, and it is going to be much more in the coming years. So we all have to work together for this group of people who are otherwise neglected. It is very challenging, though still it is very satisfying, and we need to concentrate more for this population. And Raviraj also, I must say that he took us through how he incorporated children's library and then brought the parents together to get a know-how and proper understanding of this importance of a library for the special children. Thank you. Thank you all the presenters. You have done a good job. You have worked hard, I'm sure, on this, and you have to do much more. Thank you so much. Dr. Karuna, can you also give a small...
Thank you, ma'am. I think the whole session covered a lot about quality of life. They spoke about gender differences. They spoke about balance training, functional training. We had a new ADL assessment scale, which was proposed. And also, I think quality of life, taking into consideration the children going to the libraries also. So I think we covered major areas, right from children up to the old age people. So definitely a good, informative, insightful session. And thank you all the participants. We all enjoyed it. And over to the organizing committee, the scientific committee. Please take over.
We are delighted to have you both for this session. And thank you for being such wonderful chairperson and encouraging all other participants to present.
Thank you,
Suresh. Bye, ma'am. Bye.
Thank you.